scarcity of females in the colonies has created an extensive demand, and desirable situations with good wages are easily obtained. This class of immigrants is by far the most important to the colony in a moral point of view. The great object of importing young women is not merely to supply the demand for servants, it is to restore the equilibrium of the sexes, to raise the value of female character, and to provide virtuous homes for the labouring classes of the community.
But the passage was so long that few of us could afford the expense of it without help.
A committee has been formed in London for the purpose of facilitating emigration for young women who are desirous of bettering their condition. The parties who are willing to go must be young women or widows, aged between 18 and 30, and must be of good health and character.
I was willing to go. I've lived in London for most of my life, too plain and too poor to be any man's wife. Abandoned by a mother who died in a bed, carried by a father who's sinking in debt. I work 12 hours a day on a frame knitter's team, 2 shillings a week for the gloves that I seam won't keep me out of the workhouse. I'm a stitch and a plea from its door. I'm a good girl, a quiet girl who would sail for 6 months to the end of the world. Work for a lady and tend to find home. Marry a stranger, run a house of my own. Now the government says there's a ship that will sail from Gravesend in spring to New South Wales. They're looking for girls the same age as me. Father says go, I'll be happy to leave. I hear the church ladies will raise the £6 for the boat trip to Sydney and a trunk full of gowns. This Thursday they'll answer this supplicant's prayers, provide a bonnet for winter and a letter that says, I'm a good girl. To the end of the world, work for a lady and tend a fine home, marry a stranger, run a house of my own. Each day on the deck, I would stare out to sea and I'd dream of the life that is waiting for me. An employer's kind face, a husband's embrace, good wages, good work, a most fortunate plight. For a good girl, a quiet girl who would sail for 6 months to the end of the world. Work for a lady and tend a
Mary, where? Ah, Mary. Before you can obtain permission to embark, you must send up testimonials signed by the clergyman of your parish that you are a person of good moral character and industrious habits. In selecting young unmarried women, too much care and vigilance cannot be taken to ensure that they are of good health and character. Mary Webb, the certificate you have sent up, though signed by very respectable persons, does not speak to your moral character. Now, I'm not expressing any doubt about your having always conducted yourself in a most discreet manner. However, the rules of the committee require proof. You must therefore provide certification that you have conducted yourself uniformly with propriety, and the committee will then allow you to go. Elizabeth Wade.
My lord.
It says here they found you drunk on sailor's rum. You'd fallen out of bed and you were sucking on a sorry thumb. Can you defend what I just read?
I've been in several situations, some better than the worst. But in my last position, this foolish lass was seduced. By the master's son, a spoiled rogue, deserted on the street. I took to drink and ended up in a house of correction where for dissolute wenches and fallen young women like me. I've spent 7 days hard labour, picking oakum well apart. There's the devil to pay and no pitch out to plug the leaks and cork this boat. No souls left that cares for me. My poor mother is dead. My father's since remarried. I've not seen him since he wed. Drink may be my affliction, poverty my distress. But now I have paid passage in Sydney's direction where dissolute wenches and fallen young women forget. When I met with the committee, the Lord said, Elizabeth Wade, do you still drink? I shook my head and answered, then threw me, Lord, a wink.
We'll put you in the refuge to wait upon your birth. You'll board a ship called the Strathfield Say, an emigrant boat that has promised to float each fallen young woman away.
Industrious habits. Likely to conduct herself with propriety and usefulness. Unblemished moral character.
Oh, yes, very well. You've been granted a passage on the next ship to Australia. You agree to conform to the regulations of the Immigration Committee during the voyage and to act at all times in conformity with the arrangements and obey all orders of the Surgeon Superintendent appointed for the preservation of morality, order and comfort on board. By order, the London Immigration Committee.
Stockings and handkerchiefs, ribbons and bras. father, my father. We sail in 10 days. I'll be bound for New South Wales. You'll be bound. Father, oh father, can the workhouse assist with a pint metal pot and these clothes on my list? Perhaps a fine lady would be willing to give 12 yards of calico and some pretty blueprint, 4 yards of flannel, 2 pair of shoes, a bonnet, a shawl, a nice spoon and fork, a new pewter plate, 1 pair of stays. Father, my father, we still have 10 days. I'll be bound for New South Wales.
Benevolent persons with a humanitarian concern for the plight of the poor may wish to contribute clothing or funds for the free female immigrants who are about to sail for New South Wales.
Yes.
Yes. Oh, thank you. All subscriptions, thank you very much, for these humane purposes may be directly forwarded to the Lady Soliciting Committee for several parishes. So thank you.
The better they are supplied with good, plain, useful clothes, the more to their advantage in the colony.
Absolutely. As each girl stepped on board, we received a ticket fixing the berth which we were to occupy during the voyage. And to that berth, we immediately proceeded with such as the baggage we had brought with us for immediate use. Brought up on deck at intervals of 4 weeks during the voyage. We would then exchange the clothes we had used for clean ones. Our ship left the wharf amidst loud cheers from the spectators on the pier, who accompanied their plaudits with many many prayers and many wishes for the future happiness and prosperity of their countrywomen. Lizzie's caught a sailor's heart. She cooked it up with a briny tart. Threw a wink to come what may. She says, I'll marry him before I get to Botany Bay. Sail this ship across the sea of shipwrecked souls and poor girls' dreams. Steer a course for love's fair game and take us all to Botany Bay. Constance sews fine ladies' gowns. She says, I'll flog them all when I get to town. Set up shop with the money I take. My fortune's made before I get to Botany Bay. Sail this ship across the sea of shipwrecked souls and poor girls' dreams. Steer a course for love's fair game and take us all to Botany Bay. Hannah wants to be a farmer's wife. Katie wants to lead a lady's life. Millinery will help dear Annie bloom. Fanny wants to teach the governor's brood. My desire to tend fine rooms and stoke bright fires, for I will be a parlour maid when I get to Botany Bay. Sail this ship across the sea of shipwrecked souls and poor girls' dreams. Steer a course for love's fair game and take us to Botany Bay. At 4 p.m., the pilot got us underway and we sailed out of the cove.
We could hardly move about the decks for all the women.
At 8 p.m., the pilot left us. There was rather a heavy swell. The ship began pitching.
Oh. The poor women began to get sick. The scenes I ever witnessed that night was the worst, as we could find nothing for them to vomit in. The decks were covered. I could hardly help feeling ill myself. I shall never forget 287 of them being sick, one after the other. It continued until about 12 o'clock when they settled a little.
Row, 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 row. ship sailed out on a listless sea, a departure as mild as the breeze. But as land slipped away with the lengthening day, the ocean swelled to my mouth from my feet. The ocean swelled to my mouth from my feet. To lie in this unhappy stench below, with the other poor daughters who can't hold their waters. Oh, the seas made us sick for our home. Oh, the seas made us sick for our home.
Two lights off the headlands and took our last view of England. I knew I would not go back again. I know what England is. England is a fine place for the rich, but Lord help the poor. April 1833. Old England slips away from me. Old England slips away, away from me. April 1833. The wind sounds like a mother's wail, keening through the hoisted sail. Mother, mother, keening through the hoisted sail. The wind sounds like a mother's wail.
Tonight I'll sleep below this deck. An English story you'll forget. Daughter, daughter, sleep tonight, you'll forget. Tonight I'll sleep below this deck. My final mark on England's soil, footprints left on Gravesend's shore, footprints left on shore, on shore, on Gravesend's shore. My final mark on England's soil.
Formidable destiny of our dear sister Anne, whose prompt resolution to transport herself to the Antipodes absolutely dumbfounded me.
I do not for one moment regret that I have left England.
Why, I should as soon have thought of her taking a flight to the moon. However, she deserves the highest praise for so bold and laudable a decision.
Everyone gives me credit for my heroic undertaking. I certainly think a little merit is due to me.
Dearly as I have loved her, she has now become double so to me. God grant that she may have been safely wafted over the mighty waste of waters.
Whatever trials may be, I feel proud that I have convinced you all that poor Anne and her want of energy has not proved quite the abject being that she was once thought.
To Superintendent Belby of Leighton. Dear sir, the committee entreat you to exercise your strenuous endeavours to promote the happiness of numerous friendless beings under your protection and to guard against the hazards of contamination. Signed, yours truly.
Superintendent Bilby had hardly quitted England before he abandoned his charge and left everyone to do the best they could for themselves. The consequence was confusion and complaint. And as to the man's conduct...
Still in dark, cats. there's more where that came. If you don't do as you told, Lizzie swallowed her tears. She resolved her own fate. If you did it again, she would row back to shore in a lifeboat. Lifeboat. Tyrant's reign, with a fist for each new day. He would punch a woman's fine proud nose, let it bleed until she'd faint. He'd complain about conditions, the tiresome duties to perform. He'd say, it's my misfortune to be on this vessel, but it was ours to be aboard. And we'd beg the ship's surgeon, admonish this man, that could just patch up the girls with his soft, useless hands. Some sort of protection from a willing ship's crew, granted dissolute wenches for choosing to lie in their lifeboat. Their lifeboat.
Into a community, a little village. The decks were lined with women, some working and reading. There were a great many knitting. A supply of moral and entertaining publications had been put on board and the distribution confided to the superintendent. In one of the corners will be two dozen singing. In another place will be a lot of Scotch girls dancing, with one of them imitating bagpipes. Girls composed a song naming three of their fellow immigrants with allusions to prostitutions in the galley. Crew list with Captain Charlie.
under her hind quarters came and gone.
At me as a sail away from you. In every port there are women trying to catch this sailor's eye, but there never was one lassie that held a gaze to rival this open sky. To all you pretty eyed lassies, my love, she's on the sea. I sail beneath her vast blue eye that holds my gaze, for my love has captured me.
This morning, the chaplain had the painful task to commit to the deep the body of Fanny Glover. He read the church service for the burial of the dead. The scene truly affected when sailors threw the body overboard. Heavy sea today. The waves have repeatedly broken on the deck.
Now I've fallen overboard, I lie here on the ocean floor, hear women wailing from the shore, calling me into Sydney. I'll navigate the tattooed skin, sailor boys and captain's men who drowned before they sailed into Sydney. Blow me down, I
I'm all at sea. The taste of salt unravels me. Now I'm drunk on harbor brine. Throw me down a tawdry line. Pull me into Sydney. Loved ones' bones sway to and fro, their skeletons in the undertow. Pull at my skin as they drag me into Sydney. Now I'm aboard this sinking ship. I can't escape the fleshless grip that holds my breath and swings my hips into Sydney. Blow me down. I'm all at sea. The taste of salt unravels me. Now I'm drunk on harbor brine. Throw me down a tawdry line and pull me in to Sydney. Now I've fallen overboard. I lie here on the ocean floor. Women wailing from the shore, calling me into Sydney.
Female immigrants were the sweepings of the streets of London and Dublin and other populous towns of the mother country. The description and character of some of these women had rendered it hardly possible for the presence and assistance of the Ladies' Reception Committee, in Sydney. So, such ladies of delicacy, who are an honour to human nature, cannot be expected to appear as patronesses of prostitutes.
As soon as our boat reached the shore, our arrival attracted considerable observation. There was a regular rush towards us, and half a dozen constables present could scarcely open a passage sufficient to allow us to pass from the boat. Our march to the place appointed was accompanied by half the inhabitants of the town.
I'm a good girl, a quiet girl who's been sailing for months to the end of the world to work for a lady and tend a fine home, marry a stranger, run a house in my home. I'm a good girl, a quiet girl, survived this long voyage to the end of the world. Now there's 2,000 men
waiting here on the pier, and I wanna go home. Now that I can't show my face, 'cause they might see my tears as they pour out their filth into my delicate ears. Voices screaming at us from the rough, ready shore, saying,
"Look, fellas, there's another bloody boat motor horse.